You're listening to the Co-Creator Network. When you change the way you look at things, the things you look at change.
Hey, everybody. This is Maxine Taylor with my edition of Move Into the Magic. I'm so glad you could be with us today because I'm going to interview my dear friend Catherine Carrigan. You have heard me interview Catherine before. Catherine is a medical intuitive, and some of you have her books, her best-selling Amazon books, What is Healing?, Unlimited Energy Now, and she's here today to talk about her brand new book that I know you're going to be interested in, called Banish the Blues Now. Now, that's a button-punching topic, and so many of you understand because you've gone through ups and downs, and Catherine has written a marvelous book. You will love it. In typical Catherine Carrigan format, what she has done is she has gotten to the bottom line. She has given suggestions that you can do, practical, logical suggestions, not airy-fairy stuff, but stuff that you can do that you may have never even thought of. So, without further ado, welcome, Catherine, to Move Into the Magic.
Thank you so much, Maxine. I'm so happy to be here. And thank you, everyone out there, for listening. I very much appreciate you listening. And as a thank you, I want to offer everybody a free 15-minute consult. If you'd like to contact me, it's Catherine with a C at CatherineCarrigan.com. My last name is CarrigAn.com. While you're there, you're welcome to sign up for my newsletter. Send me an email and we can set up a time for a free 15-minute consult, or you can call me on the cell. Leave a message at 678-612-8816.
And I know they're going to. I know having a 15-minute consultation, particularly when you are just so down and you need help, is a gift from God. It's just absolutely heaven sent. So, Banish the Blues Now. I love the now in the title because it really speaks to your entire approach. And I know how wonderful that is. I mean, it's the typical Aries approach. Get to the bottom line. Keep it simple. And everything just makes so much sense in your books. Let me ask you, Catherine, what made you write Banish the Blues Now?
Well, I am setting my intention, Maxine, and perhaps you, Maxine, can do this with me, and also our listeners can do this. And my intention is to create a cultural shift in this country so that when people become depressed, they turn towards holistic alternative medicine. Now, the reason that I am setting my intention for this shift is because it's my experience that holistic alternative medicine actually works better than traditional medical approaches for treating depression. Now, how do I know this? I was on lithium and antidepressants myself for over 18 years. I took the best drugs. I worked with the best therapist. I was the perfect patient. And it wasn't until I started in employing a holistic alternative medicine that I actually got balanced and I got healthy and I got happy. This stuff works. And the issue is that in our culture today, in the United States, the Centers for Disease Control reports that 11% of all Americans over the age of 12 take some form of antidepressant. So that's a lot of people. That's a lot of people who are not feeling as happy as they could. There's a lot of people feeling stress and depression. Women are more likely than men to take antidepressant drugs at every severity level of depression. Non-Hispanic white persons are more likely to take antidepressants than are non-Hispanic black or Mexican-American persons. And of those taking antidepressants, 60% have taken them for more than 2 years, and 14% have taken the antidepressants for more than 10 years. So that's a lot of people who are struggling for a really long time. And about 8% of people over the age of 12 who are taking antidepressants are not currently experiencing any depressive symptoms. However, they are under the impression that only the antidepressants can balance your brain chemistry, whereas the truth is that holistic alternative medicine actually works better. And these are approaches that I talk about in my book that you can work with your medical doctor or work with your holistic alternative practitioner that you can do and you can employ in a real practical way to solve the underlying problems so that the antidepressants are not necessary and you can free yourself from the dungeon of depression.
And so getting back to my question, did you write the book in order to, as you put it so beautifully, free people from the dungeon of depression?
Absolutely. Yes. It's my intention that people take this information and figure out ways that they can finally be happy.
And you've included so many. You know, I was looking through the book and I was thrilled that you talk about so many physical issues that we're not aware of that can actually be the cause of depression. Now, why is it, do you think, so important for people to resolve the common medical issues? I mean, it's a no-brainer, but when you're in depression, you don't know where to turn. Why is it important for people to resolve these medical issues that cause depression?
Well, great question, Maxine. And a lot of people are under the impression that when they're depressed, there's some sort of brain chemistry imbalance. And that can definitely be true. And one of the things that that people really need to think about is whatever is happening in your mind is also happening in your body. So if you have a brain chemistry imbalance, there's going to be physical imbalances that go along with that. And if you solve the underlying physical issues, then you no longer are going to feel depressed. So in my book, the first section, I encourage all the readers to put on their Sherlock Holmes detective hat and get to the bottom of these medical issues. And by doing that, you are going to solve the underlying problem, and then the antidepressants may not be necessary. So some of the physical problems that may cause depression include candida or yeast infections. That can be solved. Hypoglycemia or low blood sugar. When I'm working with clients as a medical intuitive healer, anybody who's depressed or anxious, one of the first things that I want to do is work with them on their eating and how they're eating and what they're eating so their blood sugar can be balanced. Your brain is incredibly, exquisitely sensitive to changes in your blood sugar, 2 milligrams per deciliter or less. So your mood can change with every meal. So by keeping your blood sugar balanced, your energy is going to be more balanced, your mood's going to be more balanced, you're going to feel happier. A big cause of depression is thyroid problems and other endocrine disorders. And a lot of people have the sense that maybe they're a little tired and their metabolism isn't working right. If you sort through the thyroid problems and the endocrine disorders, that can solve the problem. Environmental allergies. I talk in my book about sensitivity to your environment. Food allergies are a humongous cause of brain chemistry imbalances. So if you can identify the foods that you're reacting to, your mood and your energy can be much more stable. Amino acid deficiencies. In this day and age, you can work with a practitioner to test your amino acids. All your neurotransmitters, your brain chemicals, are made from amino acids, which are the building blocks of protein. And you can run an actual lab test to identify which amino acids you are deficient in. And the amino acids, it's my experience, that amino acid therapy actually works more effectively than the antidepressants because it's going to put into your body what your brain needs in order to feel happy. Electrolyte imbalances, vitamin and mineral deficiencies, toxic exposure to heavy metals or chemicals. I worked with a gentleman recently who thought he was having a heart attack. He went to the emergency room. because he thought he was having a heart attack. The medical doctors at the emergency room could not figure out what was going on with him. He came to see me, and I figured out that the root cause was pesticide exposure. So a lot of us have no clue how much we're affected by heavy metals and chemicals in our environment. Heart disease, lung disease, brain tumors, head injuries. A lot of people think that you would have to have some impairment in your cognitions. A lot of people go through a car wreck and have a shift in their mood. Alzheimer's disease is a major cause of depression. Strokes and seizures, high blood pressure, viral infections, diabetes. And in this country, we're experiencing an explosion of diabetes and insulin resistance. So that has a big effect on how you feel. So again, if you change the way you eat, change what you're eating and how you're eating, your mood can be much more stable. So in this book, I go through all these major factors. Another big one that a lot of people don't think about is their drug side effects. And you can go to rxlist.com and look up the single side effects or side effects of any single medication. But there's a wonderful website that I really like called epocrates.com. That's E-P-O-C-R-A-T-E-S.com. I love giving people practical information. And what's brilliant about epocrates.com is that many people who take medications are on multiple medications, and neither they nor their medical doctors are really familiar with how all these medications interact. So epocrates.com, you can put in your medications there, and it will tell you whether or not the combination has an adverse effect on your mood. So those are all really, really practical steps that you can take in order to feel better.
Wow, that's a lot. I know that I've always, as an adult, had ups and downs in moods as a woman with hormones not being balanced, etc. And what I've discovered is now that my thyroid is working at peak performance, not only have I naturally lost 30 pounds over the past 15 months, but I feel really positive. In fact, I interviewed my thyroid person, my go-to person for thyroid and hormones on the Co-Creator Network, and she was such a delight because not only did she save my life, she gave me back my life. And I think what you're describing, a lot of people say, well, yeah, I know I have that, but who do I turn to? Where do I go? Which is why, of course, I'm interviewing people like you and people like Angel Knopfziger, because you all can absolutely help people. In your book, I loved that you talked about yeast, that you talked about toxic metals. There's so much that we don't even realize. But, you know, what I've seen also and what I've experienced is you can have your hormones totally balanced. You can have your thyroid working well, and you can be going through a great deal of stress. And I think we could probably do an entire show on that. Will you share some of your stories that you have in your little bag of tricks about people who've been through very stressful situations? A lot of times we don't even realize they're stressful because we've come to live with them. We've come to accept them. It can be, what, a sick parent. It can be a move. It can be a move and a sick parent. I have a dear friend who's going through a severe stressful condition because she's moving her mother into her home, and the whole family is involved in this, and not all family members agree on any one subject, as we all know. So can you talk about this?
Right. Great question, Maxine. A lot of depression is simply pressure. It's a lot of depression is simply the pressure of change. So there's a wonderful resource in the Holmes and Ray stress scale. So that's H-O-L-M-E-S and Ray, R-A-H-E, stress scale. You can look it up on the internet. It's widely available. And it's a way of determining how much stress a person is actually under, how much stress you're under, if you're out there listening. And with the Holmes and Ray stress scale, if your total score is over 300, you're likely to get physically ill, and also that's going to affect your mental, emotional affect. So some of the big stresses on the Holmes and Ray stress scale would be things like death of a family member, moving, divorce, mortgage, new job, even things that can be really positive like a pregnancy, right? Or change in financial state, whether it's a raise, it could be up or down, vacation, Christmas, holidays. So, you know, minor infraction of the law, such as getting stopped by the police.
Oh, my God.
For speeding.
Blood pressure goes sky high.
Yeah. So when you combine all of these stresses, a lot of people demand a lot of themselves. We live in a very demanding society. We expect a lot of ourselves. But what you want is to sort of always have a handle on how stressful is my life right now. And when you're going through major changes in your life and your Holmes and Ray stress scale is high, what you want to do is, first of all, be very compassionate to yourself, because it takes a lot of energy to make change, even if it's positive change. And in addition to being compassionate, if your Holmes and Ray stress scale is very high and you're going through multiple major changes at the same time, what you want is to put energy into yourself. What do I mean by that? You want to do positive, beneficial things for yourself so that you can stay mentally, emotionally balanced. So, for example, this morning I talked to one of my clients. She found out in the past week she's pregnant. She's elated. This is what she's been wishing for 2 years. She's over the moon. And then within 2 days of finding out she was pregnant, she got a notice from her landlord that they had 60 days to move out. So all of a sudden, P.S., now we have to suddenly drop everything and move. And she's a very spiritual person. She meditates regularly. She eats extremely well. And she was confiding into me, you know, Catherine, now I'm feeling anxious. I really don't feel like myself anymore. And I said, well, it's great that you're a regular meditator. A lot of us who are spiritual people, our sort of set point is happy, healthy, calm. And yet, even when we're happy, healthy, calm, highly evolved people, when you go through major changes, major stress, you want to be compassionate to yourself and put more energy in. So by more energy in, it could be take time to meditate. It could be take time to take a nap. It could be give yourself permission to get more rest. It could be give yourself permission to take more process time. It could be make sure that you're exercising regularly, whatever your form of exercise, whether it's group sports or yoga, tai chi, or qigong, which are my personal favorites, because when you practice yoga, tai chi, and qigong, those energy exercises actually lower your stress hormones. They lower your cortisol, increase your serotonin, and can have a major beneficial effect. Another one that's available to all of us, no matter where we live, is walking. And when you walk, your brain releases BDNF, which is brain-derived neurotrophic factor. And when you walk, you actually create positive, happy brain chemicals. So, you know, at the very least, taking the time to get out in the fresh air, get some exercise. And this is very interesting because there was a study done at Duke University not long ago. And they had three groups. One group exercised alone, a second group only took antidepressants, and a third group did antidepressants and exercise. And what they found was that short term, that exercise alone is as equally effective as antidepressants, but long term, exercise alone is more effective for treating depression than antidepressants or antidepressants and exercise. So you know, we want to be compassionate because people who are taking antidepressants are looking for a solution. And at the same time, the antidepressants all have multiple side effects. And again, you can go to rxlist.com, look up the side effects of any of your medications, and Hippocrates.com to look up how they all interact. But the trouble with medication is that long-term, one of the side effects of taking antidepressants for a long period of time is actually depression, because long-term use of psychiatric medication can interfere with your normal brain chemistry. So if you can do it naturally, you're much better off. The side effects of regular exercise, eating well, balancing your blood sugar, dealing with your emotions is just happier, healthier, calmer, more inner peace.
Well, I have absolutely experienced and observed that when you're happy, you're healthy. It is absolutely so clear. True story, many years ago, it was Christmas time, and I was just sick as a dog. If there were a symptom to be had, I had it. And I didn't want to go anywhere, because when you're sick, you get depressed. It's that simple. Well, one of my dear friends has always included me in her family Christmas party, her annual Christmas party. And it's a very loving family, and there are like thousands of them. They're just amazing. And I dragged myself to the party. And I'm not even sure what triggered whatever was going on. I blamed it on I didn't feel good. Well, there's a deeper reason, of course. I just don't remember what it was, because what I find is that if you really want to be depressed, you're going to find a reason to be depressed. So anyhow, I get over there, and they greeted me with love. Everybody there was so happy to see me. Now, I thought, I can't go to the party. I can't eat. My stomach is too upset. I won't be. Honey, I pigged out. You would think that they were taking food off the planet. I ate all the foods that I would not normally eat. I had a divine time. Everything was delicious. I hated to leave. And as I drove home from the party, I realized how delightful the party was. And the closer I got to my house, the party's only like 5 miles from my house, the more upset I got, and all my symptoms came back, and I had the revelation. I have the choice to be happy or unhappy, and that I can use any excuse I want to be unhappy, whether it's a physical illness, whether it's, well, of course, the physical illness is the product of the unhappiness in that situation. It can be a family member. It can be, gee, a thought comes into my head, oh, everybody's having fun on Christmas but me. Boom. There you go. We're supposed to be jovial and happy and merry at Christmas, and a lot of people aren't. That's when they get sick. And so it became so clear to me that I could not blame anyone or anything for where I was coming from, which was I wanted to get better. And I thought, well, okay. And with that revelation, all the symptoms left.
Brilliant.
All the symptoms, I mean,
amazing,
just left, because it was so clear to me. Now, that's not always possible. Some people go through, I mean, if you're caught in a car wreck, if a tornado takes your house down, although I have to say, when the tornado took my house down, I was okay with it because I knew I'd created that and I knew why. But the average person says, what are you, crazy? And they sink into whatever emotion is handiest. And I'm not chastising them at all. Not at all. There's no criticism there. What you're saying about the relationship to optimism and health go hand in hand. When, however, my hormones just weren't doing right, and I felt something that's not normal for me, which was basically depression, hopelessness. Why bother? I thought, you know, I've got to get some blood work done. And I'm so glad I did, because my thyroid was so out of whack, she couldn't understand how I was. She asked me, how did you function? My hormones were not balanced. I had a yeast issue. And the healthier I got, the happier I got. It's that simple. So the relationship between the two is amazing. So let's say somebody's listening to you right now, right this second, and they have been depressed. Maybe they've been on antidepressant pills, and they're not working. I have clients who, one in particular, she lost her mother a few years back. She's been on medication. The medication is not helping. Now, I have a solution. It's the move into the magic classes that I teach. But say somebody's out there right now saying, okay, you're talking about me. What can I do now? What can they do right this minute? And I'm thinking, go for a walk if it's not snowing.
Yeah, but, go for the walk. Yes, good question. Well, your story brought up brilliant points, Maxine, and I want to come back to your story. But to answer your question, what can somebody do right now? I'm a medical intuitive healer. I've helped lots of people balance their brain chemistry naturally. The first thing that I do if I'm working with somebody who's depressed or anxious is I balance their blood sugar. This is essential. And because every time your blood sugar drops, your serotonin level goes down and your stress hormones go up. The hormone that you have the most control over is your insulin. And you control your insulin by what you eat and how you eat. So there is an eating plan that I usually put people on. And it is an eating plan to reset your blood sugar. So just like a lot of times if you're having trouble with your computer, you turn your computer on and off. You turn it off, and then you turn it on, and lo and behold, everything works again. And if you reset your blood sugar, that will absolutely reset your mood. It'll reset your energy and so on. So usually I start with people's chemistry first, and chemistry in this case includes their nutrition. In some cases, I will recommend people go and get their amino acid levels tested. Even people who are eating plenty of meat 3 times a day, you can have amino acid deficiencies that's causing your brain chemistry to off. Again, work through the medical issues that I talk about in the book. You can talk to your doctor and figure out if you have any of those. So I start with the chemistry first, and then I do the healing work to resolve the underlying issues. Now, as you know, Maxine, as a healer yourself, and everyone has challenges in life. They're not even really personal, although they seem personal when we go through them. But the truth is that the average person has had enough happen to them by the age of 30 that they could be depressed. And by the age of 50, they've had even more life happen to them that they could be permanently depressed for the rest of their life. And as you pointed out, a really good point, which is that happiness is a choice. Mm-hmm. And we all get to decide, how happy am I going to be? Some people accept feeling bad as a matter of course.
And they get a lot of mileage out of that. They get a lot of attention from that. So they may not want to give that up.
Yes, exactly. So one of the things that I'll do if I'm working with somebody who's depressed or anxious is I'll say, okay, I want you to rank yourself on a scale of 0 to 10. And with 0 being no depression, 10 is check me into a mental hospital. And a lot of people live at sort of low levels depression. You know, they're about a 4 or 5 on an ongoing basis. And sometimes when the levels get really high, 7, 8, 9, what's a blessing about those really difficult times is that people are forced to dig deeper. Mm. It's like, okay, I have got to find another way. This is unacceptable. I've got to find another way of living. So depression as an illness, if you will, is very slowed down energy. So if we look at it from a pure energy point of view, depression is slowed down energy. If you've ever spent time with anybody who's depressed, it feels like you're moving through mud. So the first thing to understand is that when you want to shift your depression, you want to shift your vibration. Mm-hmm. So the simple question is, what can I do today to shift my vibration? It could be, I'm going to be around people who are actually happy. I'm going to go outside in nature, in my garden, in the fresh air. I'm going to listen to music that's uplifting. I'm going to think positive thoughts, right? So the first step, sometimes you can't in that moment solve the problem or problems that is making you depressed, but you can definitely in any moment shift your vibration. And to shift your vibration, one of the things that I talk to people about, sometimes it feels overwhelming or even impossible to get out of the hole that depression is in any moment. But an easier question to ask is, what could I do right now to make myself 2% happier?
That's what I'm asking. To the person listening right now who says, should I go get a quart of Häagen-Dazs? And of course, that works. It really does. But not long term.
Not long term,
but that would be the 2%.
Yeah, that would be the 2%. So you start by asking yourself, what could I do to just make my life 2% easier? And once you realize that you have the power to make yourself 2% better, it's like, oh, what if I made it 4% better? Or 6% or 10%, and you realize that you do actually have control over the way you feel. So sometimes to shift our energy, we need to change our location, where you need to get out of the house.
Yes.
Get out of the office. Go someplace where you feel good. And as you focus on this 2% question, what can I do to make myself 2% better? What you start observing is, what actually works to make me happy? Now, in addition to being a medical intuitive healer, I'm also a kinesiologist. I'm always asking for guidance in different form and fashion. And the truth is that different things work for different people. So for some person, shifting their vibration may occur if they go to a football game.
Right.
Right? Or they play touch football in the back with their friends. Somebody else may need to lie in their hammock and get quiet. Right? Somebody else may need to go on vacation or take a walk or go to a church and pray. So it's really important that as humans, you know, one of the things that I talked about in my book, Unlimited Energy Now, is among all of us, we all have different job descriptions. I'm the dishwasher. I'm the trash manager. I'm the dog washer. But I'm also my own energy manager, and I'm my own mood manager. And if I notice that my set point has gone off happy, healthy, calm, and I'll say, gosh, I don't feel like myself right now. What do I need to do to shift to feel better? And you mentioned, you know, eating Häagen-Dazs, and definitely eating carbohydrates will raise your serotonin. And if someone is depressed, they should not be on a low carbohydrate diet.
Mm.
And I have lots of certifications, lots of training. Dr. Schwartzbein, Dr. Diana Schwartzbein, one of the people I've studied with, medical doctor, endocrinologist, and she points out that if a person is depressed, you need to get a minimum of 150 grams of carbohydrates every day.
Wow.
To make your serotonin. So you want to make sure that while you're eating healthy, you're getting enough healthy carbohydrates, which would be fruits and vegetables, right?
Or Häagen-Dazs.
Or Häagen-Dazs, exactly. And let's face it, sometimes we just get by the way, whatever we need to get by. But even going back to that whole question of shifting your vibration, sometimes what we actually need to do is to create the space so that you can feel your feelings. Feel your grief, feel your anger, feel your despair. Allow yourself to experience that. And then once you have created that safe space where you felt your feelings, do something to shift out of it. It's like, okay, I've cried. Now I'm going to do something different. I don't need to cry all day. I don't need to cry all week. I don't need to cry all month. And another really good thing to do to shift out of your feelings is to find some method of self-expression. So you and I, Maxine, are both writers. So we could certainly sit down and write about how we're feeling. Other forms of self-expression could be creating art, cabinetry, woodworking, any kind of music, beating a drum, listening to music even, and dancing is a form of self-expression, and a way of moving the energy out of you, out of your body, and releasing it in a positive way.
Wonderful answer. You know, while you were talking, it occurred to me how love is the universal antidote.
Amen to that.
That does not mean that, you know, it heals your hormone system. It doesn't mean that it heals your thyroid, but it sure lifts you up. And I think that's why when my nurse practitioner asked me, how did you do it? Because my thyroid numbers were so off the chart, I should have been in a coma. And I said, and I realized it's because love. I give it, I receive it. I felt the thyroid. I knew there was an issue. I didn't know what the problem was at the time. But when you're happy, when you surround yourself with love, and sometimes all it takes is just going over to the grocery store and being with happy people. The other thought that I was thinking when you were speaking was, yeah, and being around stress-producing people is so huge. Very often these are our family members, and they so many of my clients, astrological clients and healing clients, have non-functioning relationships or really difficult relationships with people in their families, for example, or friends, or spouse, kids, whatever, boss, that they feel trapped in. They cannot get away from that person. They may not even realize that when they're alone away from that person, they can breathe, they're happy. And when they think of getting around that person or interacting with that person, they tense up, the stress level goes off the charts, and that creates a problem. So that it may not be themselves, but their contract, their relationship with that other person, but for whatever reason, they don't feel capable or able to change the relationship or, God forbid, end the relationship. Because they're so used, especially givers, they're so used to giving to other people that they don't take care of themselves. Would you like to address any of that? Just
absolutely.
Jump right in.
Personally, I feel that we all have original wounds. And again, it's not even personal. And so what we need to do with our original wounds is find some way of healing them and releasing them. I want to give a plug for Maxine's wonderful Move Into the Magic work. It's brilliant.
Thank you.
And, you know, we all do our own forms of work. I do lots of brilliant work to release the original wounds. I find the ages the pattern started, the emotions the pattern started, how the organ systems that started. So it's really important to do your inner work in whatever form of fashion, because if you do not do your inner work, then you're simply run by your subconscious programming.
True. Very true.
And you're run by the programming specifically that your family imprinted onto you.
Right.
And so when we do our inner work, then we're back in choice.
Yes.
Right?
Yes, we're not. See, I think what happens is that when we go back into our story, our movie as I call it, we are the little child. And little children are very needy. Little children come in. And you know, our contract when we come in is that we have to forget that we are source energy. And so we are a blank slate, and that program is imprinted on us, and we are very vulnerable because we don't have the filters, the protection, that the protective devices that we learn as adults to cope, to protect ourselves, to deny whatever. It's very, very important to let that be okay, that when we're upset, we're 5 years old again. Here we are, five. Okay. And I always suggest that you count up from whatever age you're at to your current age very fast. And that will put your chronological age in tune with your emotional age. And from there, you can say, oh, that's right. He just dumped me. Yes, I'm upset over that.
Yeah.
That type of thing. And it goes back to childhood.
Absolutely. Now, and you mentioned something really important, Maxine, which is story. And so here's a simple exercise. If you're listening, and I talk about this in my book, that you can use right now. It's free. You don't need to hire a therapist. So what you do is you get out a piece of paper and you write your story. And you write your story as positively as you can, noticing as many blessings as you can. You write the story basically of your life. Then you sit down and read it and notice it, how it makes you feel. Now, the truth is that whatever your story is what is creating your brain chemistry. So if I'm telling myself the story, nobody loves me, life sucks, everything's so hard. The largest cult in the world, you do realize, is difficult. Difficult is the largest cult in the world. Life is difficult. So you write your story down. And as you write your story down, notice how you feel. Notice the primary emotions it brings up in you. It may be depression. It may be anger. It may be frustration. It may be rage. It could be 100 different things. So you wrote it down one time. Then you pause. You take some time. You rewrite your story. You write it again. And when you write it again, you're not changing any facts. You do not change anything that happened. But what you do is you write it from another perspective, a more empowered perspective. And you ask yourself, how can I write my own story from the point of view who's someone who's not a victim, who's more empowered, who created what happened, and who is able to see and recognize all the blessings? At any rate, you rewrite your story. If you have a whole life that's difficult, you do your whole life. If you do a period of your life, let's say you went through a divorce, you rewrite the whole life or the difficult period until all that is left when you tell yourself that story is peace, love, and joy.
Wow. And that can be done right now. That's what I think is so great. Immediate suggestions on how to lift yourself up if you are ready. I think what you mentioned, something that is huge, huge. The biggest role in the world that I have experienced in my move into the magic work is the role of victim. The poor, pitiful me. Boy, you're just sliding into depression on that one. It feels good to blame somebody else, but when you're a victim, there's no way out. And whether you're a victim of the government or a victim of your spouse or a victim of society or you're a victim because your check hasn't come in, that's a role. And if I have seen that if you are willing and able to let that go and take responsibility and say, I'm not a victim anymore. I'm going to do something about it. I think the greatest help for somebody who's in depression is action. Take some, when you said go for a walk, I thought, oh, that's perfect. Absolutely perfect. Get off your butt. Because a lot of times when people are depressed, they will sit in front of the tube with a remote eating junk food, which, of course, we don't even have to go there. We know what it does to your blood, to your mind, to your body. And they're watching depression-evoking movies or anger-producing movies. Now, anger, at least, when you've got depression, you turn it, anger turned inward is depression. So if you turn it outward, that's a positive thing. But nowadays, people are turning it outward violently. So we're not so sure about how to direct that. But the idea of getting off the couch and going for a walk, you joined the health club, you might as well use the membership, that kind of thing. Sometimes, even at the club, punching a bag, this, you're lifted. I've seen that happen. I watch these guys in my health club, you know, just strutting around, and I think, you know what? They're feeling good.
That's right. They are feeling good. And you're absolutely right that we need to put our feelings into action. And as you move into action, you can move out of that low energy, heavy feeling of depression into higher vibrations so that you start to feel better. I want to make a comment here because I was in another interview and the gentleman said, well, let me play devil's advocate for you. You know, doesn't this work approach only work if you maybe just are mildly bummed out? Well, I just want to give the listeners my personal story. I was on lithium and antidepressants for 18 years. I was in a support group for battered women for 2 years. I know what it's like to have had a very difficult life. And even though I was on the lithium and antidepressants for 18 years, and I managed, I, you know, got by, but I didn't actually learn what it felt like to actually be happy until I started taking this approach. And that's part of the reason that I wrote my book, is that I thought if I help even one person avoid what I had to go through, it's absolutely worth it. And I know lots of people, again, who are on all kinds of medications, and they're still dragging and still feeling hopeless and really struggling. In addition, part of the reason I would like to set my intention to change the societal shift and change the mindset about this is that when we look at this issue of depression from a global perspective, there's a lot of research that shows that the people who shot up, the schools, the churches, the military bases, the post offices,
movie theaters,
these people were on psychiatric medications.
Wow.
And we all want something that works. When I feel bad, I want to feel better. And when my loved ones are depressed, I want them to feel better. But I also want something that works for them long term. And there's a lot of research that shows that these medications actually increase our feelings of violence. And of course, fortunately, not everyone who's depressed on antidepressants owns a gun or uses it. But at the same time, because it has become such a meme in our society for these mass shootings to occur, that it's part of my prayer that with this mindset and shift towards more natural healing, that there'll be greater peace and safety for all members of society.
Oh, yes. I would certainly hope so. Gosh, the whole idea of doing something now is huge. And what you were talking about with medication, I've got to throw my 2 cents worth in here. When we talk about side effects, those are not side effects. Those are the effects of the medication. When you watch TV and you see that a side effect is death, honey, that ain't no side effect. And so I endorse everything that you do, because the holistic approach, the natural approach, is the only way to go, because there are no side effects. I'm air quoting right now.
Yeah, and I need to throw in this statistic for our listeners. 8 out of the 10 legal medications that are known to cause violence are psychiatric medications.
Mm.
8 out of the 10 legal medications known to cause violence are psychiatric medications. So it's bad for the individuals, and it's also bad for society as a whole. Whereas the side effects of eating better are greater health. The side effects of exercising regularly is better health. The side effects of regular meditation, better health. The side effects of dealing with your issues, better health on every level.
Well, I also think, of course, my approach is look at who's causing it. Now, when I say causing it, that's not pointing the finger, but I always ask people, who are you angry at? Who do you still want something from? Who has never delivered on your hopes and wishes? Who didn't give you what you wanted when you were a child and you still want it from them, even if they're not living? Because that can create anger, and you can't be, you're not allowed, you're not supposed to be angry at a parent, particularly if the parent is no longer living, and you're certainly not supposed to be angry at God. And these are top issues that I find all of us as healers are dealing with, because we have this anger inside. So I always say, find out who you're angry at. And if they're still living, don't expect them to be able to give it to you. Just back off from them if you possibly can. If I want this table that we're sitting at to turn into a velvet couch, it is impossible. It cannot. It cannot become a velvet couch. So what we have to do is get out of the fantasy that we're living in, that someday my prince will come. Someday my mother's going to love me. Someday. Look at that realistically, and all of a sudden you are free. It's that simple, and it doesn't take much to do that. Now, you can numb yourself by looking at TV, and you've got some real reality shows where people are throwing tables at each other and all of this sort of stuff, knocking tables over. So who are you angry at in this lifetime? If you can tell yourself the truth about that, you are on the way to being home free. That's my opinion. Does that jive with yours?
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, if you want to put it really simple, all illness, whether it's mental or physical, is slowed down to vibration. If you just understand that one fact, that all illness, mental and physical, is slowed down vibration. So once you understand that, healing happens when we lift our vibration. And we can lift our vibration hundreds of ways. On a spiritual level, we can forgive. We can see the blessing in everything that happened. I'm a very strong person as a result of what's happened.
Absolutely.
I know how to forgive, and I also know how to be happy as a result of this.
Let me mention being happy. Let me talk about that for a second. A while back, a couple of years ago, my best friend and I were just blah. Just blah. We weren't excited about anything. We had no complaints. We both have excellent, successful lives. And I said, let's go to the movies. And I named a movie that was kind of not X-rated. It was R-rated. But it was just one of those hysterical comedies that you don't take your children to. And we sat in that theater and we laughed. And we laughed, and all of that oxygen came into it. And we crack up. By the time we left the theater, we were fine. And I always suggest to people, if you're down, watch a comedy. Even if it is, if you have to look at the, don't look at the rating. Just look at something that makes you laugh.
That's a good point. And it's really all about paying attention. Pay attention to what lifts your vibration.
Yeah.
I'll tell another story on the opposite line. A couple of years ago, I was driving in the mountains, which was very difficult. It was dark. There was no lights. It was very scary, winding turns. And I came home and I thought, I'm going to relax. So I went into a yoga pose and I thought, I'm going to read the news.
Oh, God.
It was so bad. It was so bad. So I'm there trying to relax from my stressful drive, and I started reading this story about a gentleman in Miami who had taken some illegal drugs, torn off all of his clothes, ran down the interstate, and attacked a homeless person. And I just laughed at myself. I said, I should know better than this. This is not shifting your vibration.
That's not.
In the positive direction.
Yes, it isn't. But you learned.
I learned.
You learned from that.
Yes.
So I guess since both of us are absolutely in agreement, take that 2% step. That's all you've got to do. 2%. And I threw in the Haagen-Dazs as a joke, but
yeah,
you know.
That works.
It really, but and go, I'll tell you what I find too. Go call a friend and say, I need a hug, a verbal hug.
Yeah.
Will you hug me? Tell me something nice about me. I mean, take responsibility and call them up. And if they're busy, don't, you know, they may even just drop everything. And that love coming from them will give you your maybe more than 2%, maybe your 20%, and you'll feel so good. And then do it again. Call another friend. Because love, to me, is the ultimate antidote, and it shows up different ways. Just being listened to. Just saying, okay, I need to talk. Okay. I have a dear friend, and when I need to buddy, I'll say, I need to buddy. Or she'll call me and say, I need to buddy. And I'll say, go. And that's how we do it. Catherine, I want to thank you so, so much for once again being my guest on Move Into the Magic. I love having you. I love all of your books, What is Healing, Unlimited Energy Now, and of course your new one, Banish the Blues Now. As we know, all of your books are bestsellers on Amazon. And listeners, you can get in touch with Catherine Carrigan at her website, Catherine with a C, Carrigan, Carrigan.com. And I hope you'll come back again when you write your next book.
And it's, I've got 17,000 words written already, so
perfect.
It's coming.
Get ready, listeners. She's going to be back. So I hope you've enjoyed hearing Catherine's hearing about her latest book, and I hope you'll join me next time when once again we move into the magic. Until then, this is Maxine Taylor reminding